When I was a kid, Halloween was the highlight of my year. Every October, my friends and I would run through the neighborhood in our costumes, filling our bags with candy, trading treats, and daring each other to go to the creepiest houses on the block. But there was one house none of us would go near, the old ivy-covered cottage at the end of Willow Lane. The house belonged to a woman everyone called the Candy Witch. I don't remember who first gave her that name, but it stuck. She was an elderly woman who rarely left her house, and, on Halloween, she left a bowl of candy on her front porch with the sign that read, "Take only one, or else." I didn't know anyone who had taken her candy, let alone anyone who had dared to take more than one piece. Rumor had it that if you took more than one, the Candy Witch would come for you in the night. The next morning, you'd be gone, vanished without a trace. Kids told stories of seeing her shadowy figure on Halloween night, watching her from darkened windows. I never believed in the stories. I figured she was just a lonely old lady who got a bad reputation because of her spooky house. But when Halloween came around and I saw that bowl on her porch with its threatening sign, even I felt a shiver of fear. That Halloween, my friend Max dared me to grab a handful of her candy. "Come on, Ryan," he whispered, grinning as we stood at the end of her driveway. "You're not scared of some old witch, are you?" "I'm not scared," I replied, trying to sound braver than I felt. "But I'm not stupid, either." "Oh, come on," Max scoffed, rolling his eyes. "It's just candy. What's the worst that could happen?" He gave me a playful shove, and before I knew it, I was walking up the porch steps, my heart pounding. The bowl of candies sat on a rickety old table, overflowing with brightly colored sweets, some of which looked homemade. Oddly shaped chocolates, sugar-dusted caramels, and dark licorice sticks. The sign was perched above the bowl, its message clear in scrawled, looping letters, "Take only one, or else." My mouth went dry. I reached out, my hand hovering over the candy, hesitating. "Do it," Max hissed from the end of the driveway, snickering. I grabbed one piece, then glanced back at him, feeling a surge of defiance. I grabbed another, then another, stuffing a small handful into my bag. For a moment, nothing happened. I took a deep breath, my heart still pounding, and started to walk back towards Max, feeling a little braver. But as I turned, a cold, soft voice whispered from behind me, "That was a mistake, Ryan." I spun around, but the porch was empty. My heart was pounding so loudly I could barely hear anything else. I looked around, my eyes darting across the shadows, but no one was there. Max laughed, oblivious to my fear, and we sprinted down the street, stuffing our bags with candy from the other houses, trading horror stories as we went. I tried to push the Candy Witch's voice out of my mind, telling myself it was just my imagination. That night, after trick-or-treating was over, I dumped my haul of candy onto my bedroom floor, inspecting each piece. But there, mixed among the familiar treats, were the sweets I had taken from her porch. They looked even stranger now in the light. Dark chocolates with tiny cracks running through them, licorice sticks twisted like little spirals, and a small, round candy wrapped in faded paper. I unwrapped it, staring at the strange candy in my hand. It looked like no candy I'd ever seen before. Deep purple, almost black, with a sticky sheen that made my fingers feel numb. For some reason, I couldn't bring myself to throw it away, so I left it on my nightstand and went to bed, trying to ignore the creeping sense of dread. Around midnight, I was woken up by a noise. It was faint, like someone whispering my name from far away. My room was pitch black, but my eyes adjusted, and I saw something that made my heart stop. A shadowy figure was standing at the foot of my bed. I couldn't see her face, but I knew. I knew it was her, the Candy Witch. She stood there, her figure tall and thin, her head cocked to the side as if studying me. I wanted to scream, to move, to run, but my body felt frozen. "Didn't you read the sign, Ryan?" she whispered, her voice cold and hollow. "I warned you." I felt a wave of terror wash over me as she reached out, her hand impossibly long and thin, her her fingers curling toward me. I couldn't breathe, couldn't move, couldn't even close my eyes. And then, just as her hand reached me, she was gone. I gasped, sitting up in my bed, my body covered in a cold sweat. My room was empty. The candy I had taken from her bowl lay scattered across the floor, my trick-or-treat bag torn open, the sweets spilling out. But the strange candy, the one I had left on my nightstand, was gone. The next day at school, I told Max what had happened. He just laughed, thinking I was trying to spook him. But that night, he called me, his voice trembling. "She came to my room last night," he whispered. "I thought I heard her say my name." Over the next few days, I tried to forget about the candy witch, but I couldn't shake the feeling that she was watching me. Every night, I felt her presence in my room, lingering in the shadows, just out of sight. Then, a week later, Max disappeared. His parents thought he'd run away, but I knew the truth. She'd come for him. He laughed it off, ignored her warning, and now he was gone. And that's when the notes started. Every Halloween since, I've woken up to a piece of faded paper on my nightstand, written in the same looping script. "You owe me, Ryan. One day, I'll come to collect." Now, every Halloween night, I lie awake, barely daring to breathe, waiting for the cold whisper and the shadowy figure at the foot of my bed. I know she hasn't forgotten, and I know she'll be back.